passes, we organize them. Okay, we are about to start. What do you think? I think that we can start. And, okay. What a silence, but also what an adventure. How many hours for you from Lisboa to the next?
27.
27 hours. But then he managed to be here, right? Yes, sir, yes. Just a couple of minutes. But then he said that the driver, he was driving 200, don't tell the police, 200. Oh no, that is even worse. That is even worse. Unfortunately, this is the problem sometimes with in Italy. Beautiful things, beautiful, so many things, but Italian strikes unfortunately cause problems sometimes. And last night, Maria, she's around in the Aula Magna, and I were really suffering because. We heard that Manuel was in touch with us, and he kept on sending emails saying that he was stuck in Rome. Maybe he would take, they would put him on a bus driving, riding to La Mezia, but maybe another plane, maybe in a hotel. So I think you wrote emails until 2 o'clock in the morning, 2:30, and then eventually. An early morning flight, and Manuel Sergio Consenzao made it. So I'm happy that you're here. And I'm mentioning Manuel Sergio Consenzao so many times because I like the flavor of this name. It makes me. Good start. It makes me think of Portugal. And if I can say, just in a very frivolous way. I was planning to wear this tomorrow for the excursion, but then I said, no, today, because when I think of Portugal, I think of sunshine, beautiful beaches, incredibly beautiful beaches, and lively people. And I also remember these beaches in the north side of Portugal, where there are these small beach houses with stripes. And it inspired me. Correct? I have an amount. Okay. Now, we're honored that you're here. Thank you for accepting our invitation. And I have to say thank you to a person, the person who introduced me to Manuel Sergio Consenzao. She's Maria Teresa Zanola. She couldn't be with us today because she has other commitments, important professional commitments, someplace else. But I had actually asked her to chair this session, but then she couldn't participate. I'm here and I'm happy to chair this session. But Maria Teresa sent a very detailed profile of Manuel Sergio Consenzao that I want to read out to you. Full professor at the Universidad de Algarve, Facultad de Ciencias Humanas y Sociales, former prorector of this university in Faro, is president of the European Language Council, Conseil Européen de la Langue, a member of the editorial committee of the European Journal of Language Policy. The European Language Council brings together committed language specialists from around the European continent and beyond to support Europe's language infrastructure, improving societal and individual multilingualism and promoting quality language learning. The CEL grants institutions and language specialists access to a wide variety of projects and like-minded colleagues in similar language fields, and is open to all institutions of higher education and all national and international associations with a special interest in languages. Manu Seliukainen himself directed or co-directed several international research projects, in particular in his fields of specialization: multilingual terminologies, quality assessment in language teaching, and intercultural communication. These projects include Reforterm, Reformulação e Terminologia, Realiter, Pan-Latin Network for Terminology, a thematic network project, a TNP, on language industries-related professions, intercultural communication as part of LANQUA program, Language Network for Quality Assurance. He has also participated in ENLU, European, or INLU, whatever, European Network for the Promotion of Language Learning Among All Undergraduates, and UMART, Tuning Social Sciences, and was an associate member of the DILAN project. He's directing the section of education in the 2014-2018 European project MIME, Mobility and Inclusion in Multilingual Europe. MIME is a research project on multilingualism in Europe. And at the end of the conference, we will send you a short video showing the probably 30, 35 children who yesterday said Benvenuti, welcome, benvenuti in so many different languages, the languages we are participants, CERCOS conference participants, with the message, of course, that we really hope one day we will have a multilingual society. Funded, so MIME, funded by the European Commission 7th Framework Programme. Using an innovative interdisciplinary approach, MIME will generate and organize the body of policy-relevant propositions, identifying the language policies and strategies that best combine mobility and inclusion. Vice President of the Réseau de Lexicologie, Terminologie et Traduction, and Chevalier de l'Ordre des Arts et de Lettres, awarded by the French government, Manuel Seliukainen promotes French language studies and multilingualism in Portuguese higher education. Manuel.
Well, thank you very much. A lot of these things are not real. Well, thank you very much for having me, for inviting me.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here. I participated in the CERCLE conference 2 years ago in Fribourg because I was also a member of the MAGIC project, which we run here, and we had this meeting in Fribourg, so it's my second CERCLE conference. Thank you very much for inviting and for the effort you put to having me here, the taxi and so on. No, forget it. This is Europe. Mobility. I will talk about mobility. Well, so, as Simon said, I have some responsibilities in European landscape, in European associations, projects, and so on. And I just put here the logo of the Conseil Européen pour les Langues, and my university, and of course, this project, Mobility and Inclusion in the Multilingual Europe, is a project, as Carmen said, financed by the 7th Framework. I'm responsible of the part of education, and we have here Elisa, one member of my team, a PhD student, an Italian PhD student, who received a grant to make the PhD in the south of Portugal in these topics of European things. Well, so let's go. when I've been invited to, excuse me, but my voice is a bit strange with all these flights and no sleep and so on. When I was invited to speak about the higher education area, I think that I thought about the most important idea is the idea of complexity. In fact, this is not new, nothing new. Probably I will not tell you anything new, but I think even things who are not new have to be said and to be stressed, because we all see the reality, but we don't want to comment on it. It's a very good example is this question of multilingualism. Yes, of course, if it is in English. It's no doubt. We are all in favor of multilingualism, but yes, in English. Well, okay. So, this question of complexity, thinking that the complexity is a behavior of a system or of a component that has its own rules, and these rules are not controllable. We cannot control these rules. That's the question of language and the question of mobility and the question of citizens in Europe. This is very difficult to control. Fortunately, we cannot control. This is very complex, and this is the way we live in this Europe nowadays. So I'll speak a little bit about societal changes and European area of higher education, with this buzzy word, you know, globalization, mobility, the question of the local, the global and the local. It's very important to stress this, the question that we all are preparing our students to be, to have employment, or probably abroad in my country, at least in Portugal. Our best students go abroad. So we are preparing them to be global, but they have also to be local. So this idea of the societal changes is not only to be global, but also to be local. And as sociologists say, to be global means the locality and the globality. It's not an easy thing to prepare. Then you have this idea of mobility and inclusion, because mobility is, mobility, we all talk about mobility in higher education, because it has to be mobile, of students, of staff, everything has to be mobile. But we have also this question of inclusion. This idea comes from the project MIME, how to include these people who are mobile. Do we really include Erasmus students in our institutions, or they just have their own club, their own night to go out, etc., etc.? Is there real inclusion? Do Erasmus students really learn something about the local culture where they are studying? Probably not, or very few. So that's the question of inclusion in this sense. And then this idea of internationalization. Well, all the universities want to be international. Some years ago, European universities built campus in China. No. And then they built campus somewhere in Asia, and they have to be international, and if you are not international, you are not a good university. So you have to teach in English. Broken English, like mine, because I'm not an English teacher. I'm from advanced languages. So the idea of internationalization is without conditions. You have to be international, you have to teach in English, and to receive students that will be teach in English, will be taught in English. Do we know something about the English of these students? No, who cares? They are international, so they're no doubt, they speak English, they understand English. And for the professors, for the staff, for the library staff, for the canteen staff, they understand something? Well, they have some words in English, that's perfect. We call this excellence in Europe. This is excellence of internationalization. Well, because of this idea from sociology, this idea of recomplexification des tissus sociaux, it means our society is really more and more complicated. And we all know it, we just have to read newspapers to know it. And as Bertus said, we live in this espace sociaux de tension. That means we are in a tension, in a permanent tension of this idea of internationalization, mobility, and so on. So, as I said, we have this idea of international students, students in mobility, and local students. And we all, when talking about multilingualism, we talk about languages, and talking about internationalization, we all forget that we have some students at home. That's true. The major part, the big part of students are from our own universities. But who cares? We want just international students, because they pay more, and much more. This is very important. So, the students in mobility is not very interesting for financial questions, because they have the Erasmus charge or something like that, that they don't pay fees, so not important. The local students, okay, they will survive. But the international students, oh, that's very important. But, it's very important, but what do our institutions have plans to include, to to receive, to support international students? No, they speak English, they don't need. So, why do we need higher education? First question, the first idea presented for my country, I'm from Portugal. Why will someone coming from Poland, Romania, or Finland will come to Porto, Universidade do Algarve, to study management in English? The only question is, you want to have son, because in Finland they don't have son, or he is not good enough to enter in an English university. Otherwise, if someone wants to study something in English, they will go to an English-speaking country. That means we all are attracting international students, but that's a strange strategy. A strange strategy. Okay, but what is the role of higher education, of universities in the broader sense, high school? Well, first of all, we teach to reproduce knowledge. That means we have very good professors who wrote very good books, and students will read these books, and you reproduce this knowledge in exams, and that's perfect. First question. First role, to reproduce information, to reproduce knowledge. Then, we need also to create knowledge, otherwise it's not important, and to invent. And we have to find solutions in higher education for problems that do not exist yet. That's our défi majeur. Because if you want solutions for the problems we know, that's normal life. But we need to have solutions from things that will arise in 5 years' time. And we have to be prepared. Our students in the university will leave the university in 3, 4, 5 years and enter the labor market. And when they will enter in the labor market, the professions will be totally different. So we have to prepare them from something you don't know. And that's important. And you may say, well, it's not about the conference about languages. Yes, yes, about languages. We cannot do anything without languages. You can do that. Just to have an idea, when I was waiting and waiting yesterday, in El País, there was a text from the rector of UNED, the National University of Distance Learning in Spain, and I read it in Spanish because it's multilingualism and I hope you try to understand. And he said, in just one sentence, las universidades tienen pues metas que van más, tienen pues metas que van más allá de ellas mismas, por lo que no puede considerárselas autorreferentes y responsables. Las universidades están al servicio de una sociedad que demanda una extensión de conocimiento y de una ciudadanía que plantea necesidades formativas. You cannot agree more. That's true. We agree. What is the action plan to make this possible, to make this feasible? And concretely in our fields. We have to prepare specialists for tomorrow. Our students will be the high-level specialists for tomorrow. And they have to be mobile. If you want them, you have to go, to run for the work, wherever it is. To be mobile. With or without social rights. Because they have less and less, and we have less and less social rights. They have to be mobilized. That means they have to answer to the market and to answer to what they want them to do. They have to be competitive in the logic of production. And they have to be performance. That means successful achievers. Superman. That's what the society is asking for us. In the last report from the British Council on higher education, it is said that the future of higher education is on mobile students, staff and researchers, share teaching and delivery partnership, and research collaboration. Fine. We also agree with this, that we need, there is one condition to make this possible. condition is language. But there is, because there is no communication, no interaction, no society without language. So I'm not preaching language to linguists, not language to linguists, language teachers, but language to society. But otherwise, how can we do without language? And language is not one language. So in higher education, language are taught as a subject. We teach languages. Languages, we have to consider language of instruction. And as I said before, a lot of people think that to be international is just to use English for instruction. If you don't know, we don't have any certification of students and for professors, but we do it in English, it is perfect. Language has to be considered as language of research and language for research, because if you are just doing research in one language, there's a lot of things we don't see, we don't verbalize, we don't think about. If you just do research in one language, one question is the language of publication, and Elsevier and so on, and Reuters and so on, they want English. Okay, that's one question. The other question is language of production of the knowledge. We don't produce knowledge in the language you don't know. That's normal. And then language in universities, we have to take care of language for internal aspects, that means for their life inside the campus, and language for external aspects. For example, my university, the next university to mine is University of Huelva in Spain, 100 kilometers. And when these two universities have to communicate about things, about the equivalence, Erasmus, whatever, in which language? In English. Because these are two big important international universities. This is ridiculous. That means there is no deep thinking about languages for external aspects. For example, I have some examples, some anecdotal examples of universities from France communicating with universities from Morocco in English. So that, because the English is, because in English it's not good. So this is an anecdote, but this is real life, real examples. And we all more or less contribute to these examples. Well, at least. So we need a new conception of language. Not language as Saussure said, as a code for communication, but we need a new conception of language, a multidimensional concept. Thinking that language is a code, okay, use language to give name to the things, but language is also a mean of communication, and if there is communication, there is interaction, if there is interaction, there is doubt, if there is doubt, there is discussion, there is negotiation, mediation, and so on, and we do all this with language, and the relation with knowledge. Normally forget. We forget that we cannot use knowledge, produce knowledge, understand knowledge, share knowledge, transmit knowledge, whatever, without language. The question is, which language? Well, that means, come to that after. That means there is a centrality of language in the process of in all the process of knowledge. And as François Grand is the boss, the coordinator of the MIND project, said, knowledge is not strictly language bounded, it is not wholly language free either. That's what I said about language and knowledge. Because when you produce knowledge, and in higher education our main mission is to produce, transmit, renew, discuss knowledge, there is an ethnic culture, and we cannot do it in other languages, not the same in other languages. Because this means that there are beliefs, experiences, cultural backgrounds from students and from professors. There are disciplinary cultures, that means discourses are different from linguistics to medicine, from mathematics to anthropology, and so on. The different concept of frameworks, different paradigms, and so on, and these are conditions for languages. There are different local cultures. That's why we cannot teach in English the same way in Cosenza and in Faro. And some people think that this is international, it is European, we have ECTS, it's exactly the same. No, it is not. There is local culture, Because when we give examples in class, we give examples from our local culture, from our local knowledge. And this is a condition for acquiring new knowledge. This is the difference. So you can study art history in Italy and art history in Brazil or in the States, and I'm quite sure that the knowledge of the history of art will be different. Even the subject itself is the same, because of the local culture and because of the question of communication there. And there is also this academic culture, because academics are not easy people. And they have their own culture. They have, for example, unwritten rules. There are a lot of regulation in universities, but there are some unwritten rules, and students say, oh, look, to this professor, don't do this, because last year, there's a lot of culture from the academy. And they are also teaching skills, different styles, different learning identities, so on and so on. So the question is, in which language, and which languages, and what to do with language and science. And I use science in an etymological idea of knowledge. Scientia, the knowledge. So what do you need to do? Perhaps we should think a little bit about the use of languages in a historical perspective. In these last years, we all completely forget history. And history teaches us a lot. It's perhaps important to go back and see what do we learn about languages in, for example, very easy thing. I don't speak Italian. And today, or in the last half an hour, I had a perfect communication with my bus driver when driving at 20 per hour and talking by phone, and describing the landscape of the mountains, so I don't remember, in Cosenza and Calabria, and the route and the auto, the main route to Sicily and La Messia, and we speak a lot together. I never speak Italian. I did not speak Italian. I speak something. So we agree that you will speak Italian with me, and you try to react in the same strange Romance language, mixing Portuguese, French, three words of Italian, a little bit of Catalan. It is perfect. So this is a very important thing. That means if you go back to see what language in history can teach us, perhaps you can use the word more on intercomprehension. Perhaps you can work more in lingua receptiva and receptive multilingualism. And this can be multilingualism. Perhaps we can do here the same thing we do in Realite. Realite is the Pan-Latin network of terminology. Our boss now of Realite is Maria Teresa Zagnola. I want to thank for giving my name for this conference. And in Realite, since 20 years, we have the following language policy. Each member in the conferences, we have one conference per year and one general assembly, each member of Realite use his or her own language. Romanian, Italian, French, French from France, French from Quebec, Spanish for Spain and for all the Latin America, Portuguese from Portugal, from Brazil, Galician, Catalan, Sicilian. And the rule is, we all speak our own language, and we make this effort. You know, Romania is not easy to understand. And then when you have doubt, we have our own lingua franca, French. But okay, but it works. It works. So, because these are all Romance languages, and you have to understand. And we are publishing and making glossaries and so on since 20 years. It works. Why shouldn't we do the same in some specific context? Not in the context where we have people from different language families, of course. So, this question of territorial perspective, the question of the importance of language in the context. It means language policy has to be context-driven and not deciding the same policy for everybody. because we have this language, territorial principle, that means language are linked to territoire. Well, they are more and more not linked to territoire because of virtual aspects, because of our students, all of us, we are all out of our country, of our university, and we can take a phone and talk in our own language with our own family at home, for example. And this normally in our campus, to our students, in my campus last year, when we, 2 years ago, when we decided to check how many languages were around the country, we had around 100 languages. In the corridors, students were talking with people in, I don't know where, in this current language. So language and territoire are not so much linked as they used to be before. Then we have this idea of the link between language and personality, because personality is also a condition for languages. Language presents the essence of our mankind, so of our personality. I think we forgot this. We just decide, well, let learning, let teach English and learn English and things. Forgot that we have context and society and culture and humans and personality. Because language are the main structure of our identities. Language is our identity. Well, our is the identity of everybody. And identities are not simple things, are complex. So that means this is a complexity of language in our education area. We have to deal with complex identities and with our own complex identity. And with the perception of these identities. Because my identity is complex and people will perceive one part of my identity, and we have to deal with me if we have to teach me something, and even using a language. So it's a question of psycholinguistics, probably, but you have to deal with this also. The question of this linguistic dimension of citizenship. There is a linguistic dimension of citizenship. You cannot be a citizen somewhere if you don't know and use the language, because you cannot have, you can go to the administration and discuss and ask if you don't know the language. It's a question of linguistic dimension. And identities are not a category. Identity is not a category. Identity is negotiated, is performed, is regulated. That means identity changes from moment to moment, from space to space. Because when I'm talking with my students, I am not exactly the same than when I'm talking in a language that is not mine, with specialists in languages. And my identity here is a very controlled identity. Because I cannot say in this sort of code I'm using what I want to say. In my language, I can say what I want. In this sort of English, I just can say what I can. Not more than this. Because I have a lack of grammar structures, a lack of vocabulary, a lack of phonetics, a lack of everything to use. I hope you understand it. Well, so, that means, using the main motto of my project, we need to have a trade-off between mobility and inclusion. That means you have to take all this in account in language programs, in language policies, to take care of mobility, but take care also with inclusion. Inclusion means democratic rules, equality, so on and so on. Because in fact, our international students are not equal to our local students. I don't know who has more or less rights. Both have more and less rights. Because professors take better care of international students because, well, we try to pass them because we don't know the Erasmus world. Or because the Erasmus students cannot evaluate the professors in our European test systems. I suppose you all have European system, evaluation system, quality evaluation system in our universities. And as you know, just local students can fill the questionnaires, but not international students, not Erasmus students. That means our institutions don't want to know the opinion of the Erasmus students about what they are doing. That's strange, but it's okay. So, I think I said this, and I said this, that's okay, in other words. So, how to deal with the multiplicity of languages in this context? Because You remember, I said earlier before, a new conception of language. Because we need to take into account variation of languages, varieties of languages. For polyethnic languages like Portuguese, French, or Spain, there's a lot of varieties, and a lot of variation inside the varieties. It's the same in English. Look, what sort of English are we using? I think it was Claude Agege, the French linguist, said that this is not the, no, Alain Rey, perhaps, I don't remember, who said this is not English, this is Californian English, because of, Californian English, because of Google. Californian English. McDonaldization of Californian English, something like that. It's not real English, because English is a very rich language, as all the languages. But in fact, when we use English, like me, I'm not an English speaker, so when I use English, I just use a little part of names, or the structures of English. I cannot understand in deep the structure of English because I know my competence in English is not enough. So, there are varieties. We have to take care about languages in the language of the environment, language of our neighbors. We completely forget this. Language of our neighbors. Look to Europe. Take a map of Europe. Where are language of neighbors teach learn? Well, in some regions, in Alsace, in some regions, in Val d'Aoste, well, Italy and France, but for example, between Portuguese and Spain, Spain is a language in secondary schools in Portugal, I know, therefore 10 years ago. And why don't you try to promote the language of the neighbors? Isn't it easy to find a job in the neighbor, or do we have to go to the other parts of the world? I think it's a very simple, very easy thing. So the language of the neighbor and the question of heritage language. We talk a lot about immigrants and migration in Europe, but if you talk about migration and immigrants, we have to take care of the heritage language. And there is a lot of language loss in migrants in Europe. Not only in Europe, but in Europe. For example, a lot of second, third generation of children who cannot talk about the family at their original country. But isn't this a richness if someone, Italian parents are migrants in Paris, and if this boy or this girl can understand Italian, isn't it an add-to for the competence in society? I think so. And we have this idea, this question of new speakers. We all are new speakers. New speakers is a concept that means the new need to use a language in a new context. So when you are a new speaker, that means we change. For example, today I was a new speaker in the taxi. New speaker, that means when we have to deal with something new, unexpected, and you have to communicate, and you have to manage, and you have to survive when you change town, and you change from country, and you elsewhere. So this is an idea, this idea of new speaker, that this is an idea of how to deal with novelty, how to deal with the capacity to adapt to a language, to a context, probably we never studied. And the case of migrants, because all these migrants from Syria, from Africa, etc., they are being distributing in Europe, some come from Portugal, from Italy, they stay in Greece, but for the Greek, for them, they are really new speakers from Greek, or from Portuguese. So, we have all to deal with these big complexities, huge complexities. There is a way to solve this thing, an easy way. First of all, as the Vice President of the European Union in the recent report on the digital single market said, we have to turn the language barriers into competitive advantages. Okay, but how can you do it? It's very well. This idea, this sentence for politicians are very good. We have, how can we do it? Well, there's a solution. Use a lingua franca. We all start to use English. Well, Politecnico di Milano wanted to teach in English. I suppose you all know the history. And there were two ladies from Milano, one Maria Luisa Villa, medical doctor from biochemistry and so on, went to court and she won and said the Politecnico di Milano cannot teach in English because according, as I suppose, to the Italian constitution, public higher education has to be in the national language. But we all know in our institutions that a lot of diplomas are teaching in this sort of lingua franca. It's very interesting because this language is not English. They call it English lingua franca. There is a big research center in Vienna making research on English lingua franca, not in English, in English lingua franca, and it's another language. But the question is, Barbara Seinhofer, there's a lot of very interesting papers on this topic. I don't agree, but they're very interesting. Very, very good. But in fact, this language is not a lingua, not a language. It's just a code. It's not franca, because the idea of lingua franca of the Mediterranean, well, we are here in this lingua franca, whereas in this area, in the Middle Age, and English, the sort of English I'm using is not a lingua and not a franca. So there's a misconception of the term lingua franca. But, well, it's better to take care about local language, national language, institutional language. Because with a lingua franca, you can use it, it can help perhaps, and not against, in other situations. Well, yesterday in the airport, as I cannot express my capacity to be unhappy. In Italian, I did it in English, in French, and just one and so on. So, lingua franca is important, okay, but we cannot wait to prepare specialists for tomorrow with these conditions I defined before with the lingua franca. We need to take care about local, national, languages. For example, people say, well, but in the northern countries, Denmark, for example, who cares about? They just do everything in English. Not true. Because when people, these very high ranking specialists in bio, whatever, when they went to the street, to concerts, to the supermarket, and when they need to leave outside the labs, they have to speak Danish. Because otherwise, there's a lot of problems. Danish or Finnish or whatever. So we have to, in our conception of language, take care of local language, national language, and institutional language. We have to be more receptive and to accept code switching practices. I know I'm a linguist, a lot of you are linguists, there's a question of norm and correction and so on. But that means we have to be more flexible and accept more code switching practice in some contexts. That means we try to avoid, if possible, correlation among languages. There's always an important language, not important language. And try to be attentive about the linguistic deficit. We all have a linguistic deficit. It's normal. We cannot speak 7,000 languages of the world or something like that. So we all have somewhere a linguistic deficit. And there is a very important word. I suppose it is invented by one friend, by Régis Rix, the former rector of Université de Bordeaux, who said we all are, a lot of us are polyglots. Yes, but this in capital letters because glot means language, doesn't mean language. Glot means speaker of great languages other than English. There's a lot of other languages, yeah, really great languages. Great, that means with a lot of speakers, also in English. So I particularly love this idea of polyglot. That means speaker of great languages other than English. So that means we have new voices of multilingualism, new ideas of multilingualism. Multilingualism is just not to be able to speak three or four languages in different contexts, but to be able to use different languages in the same context. Well, I cannot say at the same time, because I just can't speak one language. But I can speak one language and understand another language and communicate. And our students will be asked to do it in the future in their jobs. Or a lot of our students will have to do it. And I'm not sure we are prepared, we, the education, prepare them for it. That means in this voice of multilingualism, we, as you say, we have to turn language barriers in competitive advantages, I quoted before, and we have this idea also of partial competence in the language. That means if I have to read texts on Sprachwissenschaft in German, if I can do, I can read this text, but I cannot survive in Germany. That means I can have a partial competence in German for one specific purpose, but I cannot be able to read develop. I'm not able to read the develop. But I think I can understand more or less text about linguistics in German. That means we also can promote partial competence according to the needs, to the field, to the needs of a student and of an institution. We are talking about help. Help means higher education language policy. And the question is, our institution, some of our institutions have very good helps. Some others don't care about it. They just want, as we said, that we need it in English or in Portuguese or whatever, and they try to manage. So, when we are talking about help and CERCLE, as I suppose it has, it's still working, the focus group on higher education language policy, because I checked the website. The Conseil Européen pour les Langues also has at least two projects on this idea of higher education language policy and on evaluation, assessment of higher education language policy. I think we have to talk about this together because that's just one with the. I think we have to join our efforts and not to run on separate ways. So CERC and the Conseil, at least for me, for the Conseil Européen pour les Langues, I think we have to discuss how to improve our collaboration. CERC is CERC, CNCL, but I think we can improve our collaboration. For example, we have three results of higher education language policies, and we don't know these results each other. And we have to, well, we'll see that. So, higher education language policy on the idea of teaching, that means in which language will we teach? In means of research, in which language can we do research? In my university, we have a lot of research groups, and in some research groups, there is no common language except English. No common language. And the question is, and we conducted a research some years ago, trying to understand if the researchers based on eco-hydrology, don't ask me what it is, I don't remember, if they speak in English, are they working more and creating more knowledge, or if they speak in their own language? So yeah, there's a lot of protocol and so on, we decide to do it, and results show clearly that when they can't use their own language, if it is understandable, language near to our languages, to explain a problem and to discuss a problem, they solve the problem with more facility than when they just use English. And there are studies on this. The Fonds National pour la Recherche, that means the main agency of Switzerland to improve and to pay for research, had conducted a project, I was part of this evaluation of this project, to understand how monolingualism is killing research. It was in biomedicine and in geography, two fields, for example, to case studies. And people say, for example, a very big research center from Geneva said, we don't use English inside the laboratory. We publish in English, we go to conference in English, but when working and researching, we don't use English, otherwise we are not competitive. That means this idea of high education policy to research. To governance, we always forget governance. Our institutions have to run themselves. And they have to run, they have technicians, they have librarians, all sort of members inside. And we need to take care of this, and take care of the structure of the university, and all these concepts of governance. And the relation with the context. Look, why should an Italian taxpayer give money to the University of Cosenza and Calabria if the impact of the result of research and of teaching in the University of Calabria is just for Elsevier? We all need to publish, publish or perish. We need to publish to our, for our careers, for our curriculum. But the result of our work has need to have some impact at global level. Otherwise, why are we here? I'm quite sure it is important that the University of Calabria has the presidency of CERN these years. You were able to put languages in the agenda of the university and talk about languages. So our activity has to be an impact at local level. But am I comparing myself with Oxford, with MIT? No. I'm thinking about people in my university. For example, in my university, we have a very important center in maritime sciences. We are just near the sea. And the research of in maritime sciences, the first important question is to improve, to help people who live near the sea in the Algarve. And then, sure, these produce results and new models and theories and so on, and it is published in the paper in the very important, okay. But research is local, has to be somewhere local driven. I'm not talking about making just research for local driven, for local. I'm trying to manage it to be local and global and compared to local, to the our own habitat. So, and we have to deal with this question of cross-border education, as we talked before. We have to deal with the question of quality assurance, because look, with this very complex idea I'm trying to design here, it's very difficult to have quality assurance. But we need to have some quality assurance and to guarantee that our work has quality. Well, if you don't do it, we receive the visit of some external commission coming from God knows where and making a report and saying complex, sometimes very strange things about our diplomas, our courses and our research projects. For example, my research center in 2008 research in linguistics was evaluated by one member of the commission of evaluation was a Swiss engineer. Perfect. From Zurich. No idea of Portuguese? Well, he spoke English and German? Well, Schweizdeutsch. And he was evaluated, so I think we have to see ourselves how our quality assurance is maintained. It's very important. Not the quality decided by international agencies, but first of all, our own quality. I mean, can I sell my course to these students being honest? Sometimes we are not very honest to these students. Okay, that's it. So, we need to have a global positioning, as I said, and a locally important, as I said also. And we have to, don't forget the cost of monolingualism. Monolingualism is very, very, very expensive. It's more expensive than multilingualism. Perhaps not in financial terms, but in cultural, individual terms. And that this idea of decapitalization of languages. That means you say, well, I try to know. For example, we have students from the Eastern Europe, students from Ukraine, and they say, I avoid to use Ukrainian in the campus, because Ukrainian is a language of migrants in Portugal. So it's not an important language. I prefer to use Russian. They speak Russian, not all of them. And when they speak Russian is a language of a huge country in Europe. But Ukrainian is a language of migrants in Portugal at least. So we all have this idea of decapitalization of some languages. They don't have the enough capital to be important. Look, which languages are we teaching in our language centers? The most important language. But who decide who are the most important language? We did it. With which criteria? Our own. And that's it. And sometimes we all are teaching Chinese. Right, a lot of Chinese. What for? Will a student having 1 year or 2 years of Chinese 2 hours a week, 4 hours a week, be able to speak Chinese in China? Never. But all the language centers around Europe, well, no, I don't know. My language center, we have Chinese. Sure, we have Chinese. What for? Because my students have, they are in Chinese twice per week, 1.5 hours each class. And by the end of the year, they may have 90 hours of Chinese. Well, and 90 hours, I don't know, but look. But we have to discuss, that's why I was saying in the beginning, I will tell you not new things, not new. But I think it has to be said. We have to put the finger on the thing. We have to think about private life. I told this, in Portugal, the Chinese is a national project of a protocol with China, and I told this in the ministry, and said, well, you want to put Chinese in secondary schools, it's perfect, wonderful, folkloric. The students of 16, 17 years have 2 years of Chinese. This is perfect. And the only language they have, because in secondary schools in Portugal, we don't just have one language. And some of the students in 11 schools in Portugal, this is a pilot project, they choose Chinese. This is perfect for life. Okay, so I talk about this lingua receptiva, about the comprehension. We are talking about the multilingual competence. I don't know if, look, I will be here till the, I try to finish in 5 minutes, okay?
Okay, okay.
I completely forgot the time, excuse me. But we are talking about multilingual competence. And for those who were this morning, Elisa is preparing there, my student, preparing a thesis on multilingual competence, PhD in competence, I suppose she presented this morning. I wasn't there. Some data about multilingual competence in different universities in Portugal, in Catalonia, in Antonio. So, this idea of multilingual competence is the idea of a cognitive dimension and the social reception. And the multilingual competence is not just not add monolingual competences. That means it's not I have a very good French, I have a very good Portuguese, I have not very good English, and so on. A multilingual competence is the capacity to put together all these competences and use them in communication and in work and in life. So that is this idea that means helps our education language policies need to create these multilingual ethos. And this idea from philosophy, the need to create this identity, the ethos is the identity of a group, this multilingual ethos in higher education area. So I will just quickly to do it in higher education. We are talking about specialized communication, about specific knowledge, not knowledge from the street. We are talking, for example, about terminology. Students need to know terminology in these languages, and they need to know syntax and so on, grammatics and so on. But they need to know how to deal with terms, and terms are specific identity linked to concepts and linked to knowledge. We need models to share and to understand and to prepare to localize the this information, this knowledge. It's also a way to prepare students in which language, how to teach, how to learn, and to whom. And there's another question. That means, let's look at languages, but who will teach? We are old professors with new complexities and new defeat, and we have to adapt ourselves to this new world. Because our students sometimes don't want to come to class. They want to stay at home via Skype. Because a lot of some language professors and linguistic professors ask students to use the smartphone in class, because they send the exercises to the smartphone, the students answer, and we have the projection of the results on the blackboard, on the whiteboard. But are you prepared? I'm not sure I'm prepared for this. But this is life nowadays. Because the way to teach and to learn are totally different from ours, when we learn when we are students. The way to teach, we were not prepared to teach this way, that means with all the virtualities, with all the technologies, and without dictionaries, without grammars. When I start teaching French, when I start teaching Latin and French and so on, my students need to have a grammar, a dictionary, a very good dictionary, from Latin or from French or whatever. Nowadays, my students just need, in fact, the French just need their smartphone because it has Google, and Google says, knows everything. And I have to prepare my methodology to this. Like, I cannot avoid, I cannot say, good, leave your smartphone outside the room and bring your big dictionary. No, it's not possible. Okay, well, I talk about this. Let's speak a little bit, because you need to have lunch. Well, we are talking about, I have two or three more lessons. This idea of formal, non-formal, and informal education. More and more, in language classes, we are using non-formal and informal education. Because formal, acquiring a multilingual competence in formal education, in higher education, seems very, very complicated. You cannot acquire a multilingual competence with formal classes in higher education. You need to have informal, that means the cafe, that means outside. You need non-formal, that means what sort of initiatives on languages and culture and so on and so on. So, in language teaching, not language center departments, we need to take care also about non-formal and informal language. Because we all live now in these multilingual and multicultural learning spaces. It's not just the classroom, not the group, but these multilingual, multicultural learning spaces. This term, multilingual and multicultural language spaces, is a term from this European project InterUni, International Universities, was conducted by our colleague Karen Lauritsen from Aarhus University. If you are interested, you can hear InterUni. There's a lot of information about internationalization criteria and so on and so on, according also to languages. So, we need to think about the curriculum, be it explicit or implicit, because it is informal, it's not explicit, and about internationalization of this curriculum, and to have an international curriculum, this is not teaching English, this is prepare the contents, the activities, the structures, the strategies, the assessment in an international way, taking care about international identities of students who are in class, and that's not very easy, not easy. But internationalization does not mean teaching English. We have to think about new methodologies, because our old methodologies, pair work, filling the gap, so on, and strategies, they don't want us to do this. They don't want us. We have to talk about new resources, not only physical, but virtual resources, and evaluation when they are at home, for example. New strategies, I said it, new categories such as openness, behavioral, flexibility, communicative awareness, knowledge discovery, are now assessment criteria. In the old days, criteria were good spelling, syntax correct, pragmatic adapted, and so on. And now we have to evaluate in language all this. For this, please see the website of the MAGIC website. Jero here was one very active member from Groningen on the MAGIC project. This magic means modularizing academic competence, whatever. Magic. I don't have time to memorize. So it's very important, this idea of flexibility, openness, knowledge discovery. We have to evaluate this. This is also Bologna, because Bologna has these non-presential hours of work, autonomous work, and we have to evaluate it. Well, we can evaluate on knowledge discovery, for example. We have this problem of assessment and certification after this, quality control after this. Now we have to redefine new methods to assessment and to certificate. How can we certificate informal knowledge in language? Is it possible? Yes, it has to be possible. Can we do it now? Not yet. Research is needed on this. And the question of representations and facts. The idea, we have some representation about our students about languages, and the fact is not like this. For example, this idea from Harrison saying English is sometimes a constraint of efficient learning, because sometimes the gap between the expected proficiency in English of our students and the real one is a very, very huge gap, and you have to take care of this. That means we need to have research to find answers. I put answers in the title, but I don't in research for these complexities, and research, for example, on evaluation on higher education language choices. Why these some institutions decide to teach these languages and not other languages, and to teach in this language and not in another language. It's not just to constat, it's also need to research which is the reason, and to justify. Research on linguistic dimensions in the campus, outside the classroom. Who cares about the classroom? You know, there is a very important, very interesting paper on brain science, the magazine Brain Science, saying that they measure the intellectual activity of students inside the class and outside the class. And they prove that the intellectual activity is lower inside the class and very, very high outside. Because in class, we all be prepared to be there, sitting and waiting, and taking notes. Well, perhaps not in some classes, but... So it's very important to research. To have research not only on this pedagogical area, because we have a lot of research on didactics and pedagogy, a lot of research. But we need research also in the relation between the pedagogical choices and the strategic intention of the teaching, of the course, of others. Well, so my question is, I'm almost finishing, my question is, why can't it be done in, with, by, in, with, by language centers? Because I know the language centers in Europe is a very different status, but in some countries, you have in the university the language center, that means those who are just teaching languages. And then you have the very important people in the department of language, because they study medieval literature and they study translation of poetry or whatever. Perhaps we have two in the language centers. It's not the case in my country, for example. It's not so different. So, but perhaps we have language centers in these sort of institutions can ask for them to make research to prove they are absolutely indispensable in these institutions. Because in some institutions, language centers are just a thing from, well, this sort of not professors, not they are just, they have partial contracts, and they're just giving classes, and okay. It's not serious to do that. So, I think the language center is the only institution inside higher education who has the real knowledge of these complexities. Because these things happen in the language center, where you have to prepare students for languages. The main generic answer, as I told you, first of all, we have to be aware of these complexities. That's why I'm finished now. I was trying to say a lot of whole things. We have to be aware, and to be aware we have to verbalize and to say it. Because sometimes I know it's important, but I have time to read, also forget it. We have to see it, to say it. And then we have also to link languages to contents, language to knowledge. I'm not sure it is clear, because I'm not totally sure that we may have clear in higher education. But a sort of clear applied to higher education. But link languages to content, to knowledge, to society. And it has to be done by us, not by others. Has to be not the chemistry of the medical doctor. We have to do it. And we need to create this multilingual ethos according to context with equity to enhance the title of this conference, Critical Thinking and Creativity for a Global World where People Will Stay Individuals. Thank you.
Grazie Manuel per questa bellissima e interessante presentazione, tra l'altro piena di ironia, principalmente you were not expecting me using Italian. principalmente Per questo quadro anche ironico è molto realistico di che cosa significa internazionalizzazione nelle università europee. I just said, maybe in a more perfect Italian than English, but thank you for this very insightful and full of concepts, of representation, full with humor, and for this realistic picture that you gave us about in this international process in European universities. So many concepts, so many keywords that I jotted down while you were talking, the centrality of languages, culture, considered from the ethnic, disciplinary, local, academic perspective, languages and history, intercomprehension, language and context, language and personality, language and identity, promotion of the language of the neighbor, then the concept of the new speaker when we're dealing with novelty, lingua franca, also the capacity of expressing how to be unhappy, the code-switching practices, and so on and so forth until we got to this quality assurance. And then I was jotting down your final global word where people can keep on being individual. Thank you. I think now we can... open the floor to questions. No, we have time for Donato.
I have
okay.
A question. I don't know if you can you hear me without a mic?
Yes, very well from here.
I found many points of contact with your presentation with yesterday's keynote speech, in particular concerning multilingual competence. Yesterday, one of the key points was that a lot of people are unwilling to define themselves bilingual, multilingual, maybe because there is a wrong concept of proficiency. So the question is, should we revise our concept of language proficiency, or have we gone too far with some ideas of language proficiency?
Thank you. I think we have to redefine this concept, because the concept of language proficiency, for example, the European Framework for Languages, has been defined for monolingualism. And for example, we need to have a concept, there will be a framework for multilingualism. And there is a pilot framework, well, a very good, not a pilot, very good framework. I will advise you to consult the website of the MAGIC project. MAGIC, we have there a framework prepared by our colleague Anna Razanen from Finland and Birgit Foster-Frosiski from Lausanne. They prepare a framework on multilingual, how to evaluate, how to describe and to evaluate multilingual competence according to the province proficiency in partial competences in languages. Because the definition of proficiency in, for example, the European framework, you have a B2 if you have this sort of capacities in all the sub-competences. And in multilingual competence, you cannot have it. You may have C1 in the reading competence, for example, and have A1 in the overall production. And so there is an example in the MAGIC website. You can download it, you can read it. But it's not enough. You need more research on this. We have also to, it has not been done, to link the multilingual competence to the content we need to express in this language. And this is very it's more and more complicated. If you know the Mandelbrot process of complexity in life, everything is complicated. Each element is will complicate exponentially the previous one. That means, when I'm defining multilingual competence for an engineer, a Portuguese engineer living in Germany, he has Portuguese in different competence of Portuguese as mother tongue. Then he has probably English, just for the profession. Then he tried to live in Germany just to live there and to buy abroad and so on, bread and so on. That means I have to about Deutsch. That means we need to describe the linguistic proficiency according to the content that we need to express in this language. Because the question of terminology and then the question of level of language and so on. So this is very, very theoretical yet, and I don't have the proper answer. There's one thing I forgot to say. We always forget the question of the first language. We all talk about languages and languages and languages, foreign language. Please don't forget, I will not say mother tongue because you don't know anymore as a mother tongue, but you understand the concept. First language. We don't take care enough about first language of our students. And their competence in first language, at least in the context I know best, in Portuguese, in Spanish, in French, is worse and worse. Even in higher education. Because we are always very interested in teaching them English and French and Spanish and whatever, and they need more knowledge in mother tongue.
From Donato Martano to Sabina Schaffner.
Yes, thank you very much also for bringing up a whole lot of interesting ideas. And it's not a question that I have, I'm from Switzerland, but it's more feedback. I think you gave me so much inspiration how to find good arguments for things we are going for and fighting for, how to rediscover and make it more accessible a good Swiss tradition of intercomprehension, which is getting lost the longer the war among younger people. So yes, I think we really should also get together in different contexts among our colleagues here and just go on thinking and discussing the ideas you just presented. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you.
Over there. Up. Good. Quita.
Hi, hello. My name is Catherine Xiang. I teach Chinese at LSE. So I guess I don't see many other Chinese teachers here. I feel
where,
like
where
I need to...
Where?
LSE, London School of Economics and Political Science. So I really, really enjoyed your talk, and I clearly understand the point you make about, you know, Portuguese students learning Chinese for 2 years. Where are they, you know, leading to?
Lars Perik.
But I want to comment on that. I think, really, if we separate the speaking language of the Chinese script, it's possible. It is possible. And they can actually get to a really good level in Mandarin Chinese and travel to China, use the language. And believe me, if not, welcome to LSE, I show you. Of course, and also it's actually encouraging to hear that many Portuguese students want to try something very different. So I just felt, you know, as a native speaker, I do want to kind of comment back on that. But of course, if they want to develop, you know, all the four language skills at the same time, I agree with you, it's going to be quite challenging. And like learning any language, it needs continuous, you know, development and practice. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and please apologize. I was not sufficiently clear. I'll explain. The question is, the content of the curriculum of Chinese in the Portuguese schools is made according to the image of other languages. That means they pick the English program, the French program, the Spanish program, and they more or less translate it to Chinese, which is not possible. And I know it, I agree with you, but I know it because your institution collaborates in the design of European framework for Chinese that is used. There is an European framework for teaching and learning Chinese, and it was, well, part of the work has been done in the London school. The descriptors are on the internet, you can use them, and it's very clear that you can promote, like in other language, promote a sort of competences, not Chinese reading, but writing, but all about the competence. But my critical was too much local, perhaps, because in Portugal, they prepare the curriculum copying the curriculum of other languages, which is completely right, in my useful. For example, students are now trying, at the end of the first year, they need to know 80 characters. I don't know why 80, but you know, yes. That's why I always make critical. But I agree, thank you very much.
From Catherine Xiang, too. One more. No more. We're all stopped at this point. What do you think? Okay. But please don't forget that Manuel is going to be with us the whole afternoon and then evening. And the conference dinner tonight is not going to be sitting at tables like this, but we can move around so we can continue talking about these issues even over dinner tonight. And then you will be with us again tomorrow and at the round table. So we will have the chance to reflect on these issues again. At this point, our morning is over. Many participants asked whether they could go straight to the hotel right after the keynote speech, because they want to have some rest, or they want to, you know, because the afternoon is going to be pretty long, afternoon and evening. So if there is some food, some more food, just grab something very quickly, but be aware that the buses are already waiting for you here in the nel piazzale dell'Aula Magna. Ci sono gli autobus che vi stanno aspettando e che vi riportano negli hotel.
I made my case. Multilingualism is arriving.